The people I organize with, they dream of having $0. That's the American dream today. That's what it means to want to be out of debt, to be back to zero. And now we just take it for granted, like, well, of course you have to take out loans to get an education. That's not true. That's not how the system was built. And that's a political choice.
Today in America, 43 million people find themselves holding more than $1.7 trillion in student debt. To understand how we ended up in this crisis, I spoke with writer, activist, and filmmaker Astra Taylor.
The seeds of the student loan crisis, without a doubt, were planted in the 1960s in California. In California at the time, college was free. There was something called the UC Master Plan. It was basically, education's a public good. It's free to all. And that actually was in keeping with the spirit of the founding of many of the country's public universities, educating the public for free so that we can have an educated citizenry and we can be competitive in the arts and in industry, etc. In the 60s, the group of students accessing that education were diversifying. There were more Black students, more women, and
this is going to be a revolution. There must be a revolutionary party.
The kids were getting political.
The individualism that he's indulging in is going to get him killed.
Resolutely struggle against bourgeois individualism.
Meanwhile, film actor Ronald Reagan's conservative backers, hoping to unseat Democratic Governor Pat Brown, persuaded him to enter the Republican primary for governor of California. Reagan campaigned against big deficits, high taxes, and civil rights. He criticized Governor Brown's response to the Watts riots and promised to crack down on student protests.
When they get in that poll, and they have to make a decision between a governor that's been acting and an actor, I think they're going to pull that down for Pat Brown. That's my opinion.
Reagan won by nearly a million votes.
Reagan, very consciously drawing on the insights of neoconservative and neoliberal economists at the time, said, we've got to make these kids pay.
Well, if the government is going to build the schools and buy the books, issue scholarships, make judgments, and exert pressure, what if one day that pressure is of a political nature not to our liking?
Imposing tuition and debt on students was part of a right-wing, reactionary, and racist political project. If you're paying tuition, you're going to think twice about carrying that protest sign.
While one seed of today's student loan crisis, the defunding of public colleges, was planted by Reagan in California, another was planted by President Lyndon Johnson in his Great Society legislation.
Will you join in the battle to build the Great Society?
At the time, tuition costs, though low, were still restrictive for working class students, and private lenders did not want to loan them money. So Lyndon Johnson and the Democrats passed the Higher Education Act of 1965, where in Article 4, it created a federal student loan insurance fund to back private lenders. If the kids default, the government guarantees the loan.
So instead of democratizing access to education by increasing funding, what they do is they increase access to borrowing. That's the bargain that's made. Beginning, student loans were used to sort of pay for extra things.
You don't own me.
It's like maybe your housing, because Pell Grants at the time typically covered tuition plus. You could buy your books, and also the minimum wage got you a lot more, so you could work a part-time job as a college student and you could probably pay your rent and more.
But by the 1990s, student loan debt began to skyrocket.
My favorite part about graduating now would be dodging my student loan officer for the rest of my life.
In 1994, the average debt of a bachelor's degree graduate was around $10,000. 5 years later, it was $15,000. However,
it wasn't a problem that experts and economists felt was worthy of paying attention to. Today, a student going to the University of Delaware, so that's where Joe Biden went to college, adjusted for inflation, a student pays $90,000 more to go and get the same degree that Joe Biden got. Wages are stagnating, unions are being crushed, and what workers are told, what citizens are told is, the problem's you.
What's your story? What are you doing to make sure you become successful?
Are you satisfied where you are right now?
This couch is not your friend.
You have a dead-end job.
Feel like you can't move forward.
You have no excuse.
You can start your career training at the school.
They care about you. They want you to succeed.
They're with you every step of the way
for the rest of your life.
Change starts right now.
You're seeing people who are poor. They're trying to, you know, make their lives better. And then they go, oh, well, I guess the only thing I can do is enroll in college.
I was at two dead-end jobs. I was not happy. I didn't wake up happy. I didn't go to bed happy. And I knew at that position I wouldn't be able to support a family. And I knew I couldn't do that without an education.
So then suddenly the for-profit college sector booms and people are buried in debt. The very people who need upward mobility take on student debt and then get dragged down further into this financial hole and are most risk of default.
You're not gonna believe me. And I need you to remember what I'm saying, okay? This thing, it's gonna follow you.
What student debt is today is a kind of mobility tax on poor and working class people.
Wherever you are, it's somewhere walking straight for you. All you can do is pass it along to someone else.
This is the magic of capitalism. You have debt because of fees and interest. That debt compounds, it grows, right? So you sink further and further and further into the financial hole.
We need student loan forgiveness beyond the potential $10,000 your administration has proposed. We need at least a $50,000 minimum. What will you do to make that happen?
I will not make that happen.
Because back in 1965, when they passed the Higher Education Act, they also gave us the nuclear button to erase student debt.
When you have the ability to issue debt, by definition, you have the ability not to collect it. So the Higher Education Act basically gives the government the authority to not collect on the debt that it's lent out. It's all owned by the federal government, and the federal government has the power already in its possession to cancel it all.
This authority is already being used right now to cancel the interest owed on all federal student loans during the pandemic. Now it's time to use that same authority to cancel all federal student debts.
We are sentencing an entire generation a lifetime of debt for the crime of getting a higher education.
Why can't we treat our student borrowers the way we treat our banks? 44 million Americans, that is too big to fail. I know.